weeks and then he could sit and work without getting disturbed by the children, which is what was happening in their apartments and things of that sort. So we had a wonderful time. I said, very good. You had a wonderful time. You bonded better with not only your son, but with your grandchildren and all that. I'm very happy for you.
But I said, does it take a pandemic for you and your son and your grandchildren to bond together? Why could that not have been done without a pandemic? Your son and his family knew that you live in a big house with a garden, and you know that small children love to go out and play rather than be cooped up in a two-bedroom small apartment and things of that sort. So that brings me to a very important question. Any relationship which is forced on us, I want you to introspect that, is it because I want it or because I feel that there is no choice and therefore I try to make the best of it? That way I can tell you one thing about us, people in the Indian culture or even Oriental culture, I would say. We are very adaptable people. We have been trained from day one. You have to respect your elders. You have to obey your parents. You have to obey not only your parents, but if you live in a joint family, you have to obey your grandparents, your uncles, your aunts. In many cases, if there is a domestic help, if there is a maid servant or somebody who is a little elderly, the children are told that you have to obey her also. She's also equal to your mother or grandmother or something of that sort. So it is so drilled into us that we feel that there is no choice left. And then when you ask, how's your relationship with X, Y, Z? We very easily and very positively, we say, yeah, my relationship is very good. Because we have not seen anything beyond that. We don't know whether there's a choice. I saw a wonderful cartoon. There's this Beetle Bailey cartoon which comes in the newspaper. I hope you all know what's a newspaper, Once upon a time, we used to read. Again, pre-pandemic and post-pandemic and all those things. Anyway, there's this cartoon strip of the army fellow Beetle Bailey. One day, the cartoon strip was very cute. He has a general, General Halftrack, who's a very elderly person, maybe married for 40 plus years or whatever it is. General Halftrack and his wife are lying down in bed side by side and both of them are reading something. Suddenly, the wife turns to the husband and removes her reading specs and looks at the husband and says, "Do you still love me?" Dangerous question, right? The old man who is reading his book pulls down his specs, looks at his wife and says, "You mean I have a choice?" Besides the humor, think of the seriousness, the philosophy behind it. He actually meant it. He said, "Do I have a choice? You and I are married to each other. We are life partners. We've been living for 40 years. We'll probably live again for whatever 10, 20, 30 years, and one by one we'll just pass off or something. But do I have a choice whether to love or not?" And that is what true relationships are based on. Yes, you have commitments. I'm not denying that. I'm not saying you should give up on your commitments to your close relationships. But your emotions are not controlled by commitments. It should be the other way around. Your emotion should make you feel committed rather than you trying to build an emotion around a commitment. And that, to a great extent, is what the pandemic did. It pushed us into feeling that we have no choice. We have to do this, we have to do that. Okay. For a minute, let me just take you one step back and clarify what is a relationship. A relationship, by its very definition, has to be two-way. It has to be give and take. When you only give to somebody, you give charity to somebody, you have no relationship with that person. You are receiving something from someone one way, it's not a relationship. You'll be grateful to that person, you'll be thankful, you will respect that person, but you will not have a relationship with that person. Every relationship has a give and take. In fact, when I tell people, that relationships are exactly like any other commercial transaction. People get very angry with me. How can you equate a relationship to a commercial transaction? Come on, Ali, that's not true. You can't say that. To me, relationship is unconditional love. I love that phrase, unconditional love. People banter it about so easily and so freely. But I want to tell you something. If you have unconditional love, then you don't have a relationship. The only one person I feel with whom you can have unconditional love and a relationship without a give and take is the one sitting right up there. And that is again something which has always intrigued me. Anyone else promises you something, or you plead with that person and say, I want this, please. And I'm willing to do something for it. I'm willing to work towards it. But you must give me what I'm asking for. If that person doesn't give you, what happens? You get extremely angry, no? You start saying, hey, this person is letting me down. This person is cheating me. This person is disappointing me. But what happens with God? God, please give me 90% marks in the exam. I'm studying so well. If I get less than 90, my parents will be very disappointed. I won't get admission in MBBS. Please, God, please, please, please. I'll do everything. I will go to temple. I will pray. I will study. I will take coaching. I will do everything. But please give me 90%. And then what happens? The result comes and you get 70%. You don't go and, shout at God and say, hey, what a stupid fellow you are. I did so much and I had so much expectation. Go, I'm not talking to you or something of that sort. Nobody does that. In fact, this morning on TV, that wonderful film was going on. I just got a glimpse of it. Oh, my God. Paresh Rawal. His, the whole shop burns down. And he has lost everything, business and assets and money. So what he does is he goes to the insurance company and says that my shop is insured. So you better give me. The insurance fellow very cleverly shows him one small fine print which says acts of God are not covered by insurance. Any other damage to your shop, we will pay. But if it is an act of God, we will not pay. So then he says, then whom do I ask for? He goes to God. And how do you go to God? He goes through what he calls as the commission agents of God. The pujaris and the people running the temples and mosques and church and all those type of people. Anyway, that was in a very lighthearted manner, but it was really an eye-opener if you deeply think of it. Because that's the only relationship. Please understand, that's the only relationship where you are willing to give up expectations. All other relationships have expectations. Now, when we get locked in and when we are forced to live together or whatever it is, like this example I gave, that the son moved in with the parents along with his family, or whatever you did, or so many people who had never stepped into the kitchen, the housewife or the homemaker was the only person in the kitchen for years and years, and suddenly the son and the husband and everybody is walking into the kitchen and cutting the onions and this and that sort of thing. My very simple question is that how come it never struck you that your wife or your mother for hours is doing this cutting today, let me go and do it. If you had asked even 1 month before the lockdown, they would have said, yeah, I want to help, but I'm very busy, I've got so many other things to do, I have so many commitments. Some even would go to the extent of saying, no, she doesn't want interference, she is very happy doing whatever she is doing. So we don't want to go, and too many cooks spoil the broth, so we don't want to interfere and things of that sort. Suddenly what happened? And the interesting thing that is going to come out is what is going to happen. So whether you like it or not, one fine day, this pandemic will become history. If you don't believe me, go back 100 years, exactly 100 years back. Bangalore and many, many parts of the world were struck by the plague. And the plague was not like a pandemic, where 2 people, 5 people, 10 people dying. Entire localities got wiped out. 1/3 of Bangalore population people died. Can you imagine? The equivalent of that today would have been Bangalore has 1 crore population. Can you imagine a situation if 30 lakhs people had died due to a pandemic now? What would have been? If there are 3 people in the family, 1 person would have died statistically. It was that bad. And yet, how many of you have even heard of that plague before this pandemic came? It's wiped out. It's gone. Nothing. But it changed lives. And that is what is going to happen. That is the reason why I thought I'll talk today about what is actually happening to you. I want you as an individual, don't even think of commitments, as I said. Don't think that I am somebody's spouse, somebody's parent, somebody's child. Those are all defined relationships. They were there, they will be there, they will continue to be there. But as an individual, how have your relationships changed? And not on the short-term basis of, yeah, we all sat and played board games together, and all, my son came and helped me in the kitchen, or my little four-year-old is dancing and we made this video and we put it, and you know, there are 4,332 likes for her dance which she did, and this and that. This never ever lasts out. At the deepest sense, your relationships, how have they changed? I want you to introspect. I'm not going to give you answers today. I'm not going to speak on your behalf today. I'm not going to point fingers and say, no, this is done, that is not done, this is where you are right, this is where you are wrong. I always believe that anything that comes from within has 10 times more effect than whatever is told from outside to you. The one thing which I have been always cautioning people, right from students who want to take, you know, choices about their career, to anything, you know, whatever activities you want to do, which city you want to live in, the type of profession you want to do. One of the things that I have always been talking to people about is to avoid what we refer to as the herd mentality. Not H-E-A-R-D herd, but H-E-R-D herd. Just now when I was coming in, I saw a cute herd of sheep. There were about 20-30 sheep which were going. And I always get fascinated by this. Those of you who are city people, please go out and see. Even here you could see, or you go into a village and you'll see a herd of 50 sheep. 50 sheep. Each is a live being. Each has got a brain, a thinking power. And how many shepherds are required to control those 50 sheep? It could even be a little boy, it can be an old, fragile lady. Now you'll wonder, if these 50 sheep start running in 50 different directions, how will the shepherd control them? Go and observe. What the shepherd does is, okay, they've been grazing, they've been having a nice time. He looks at the sun and says, no, the day is coming to an end. I have to take them back and put them in the enclosure. Now the sheep are enjoying the grass there and they are being told, leave it and come. It's like you are in a banquet and there's this beautiful spread all over, and suddenly somebody comes and says, stop eating and get out from here. No sheep wants to leave. So what does the shepherd do? He comes to the first sheep, perhaps ties a rope and starts pulling. If the fellow still refuses, he takes a twig from a branch and gives it one whack on the bottom. That poor fellow is getting throttled and beaten. He has no choice, so he starts walking. But the very interesting thing is, the second sheep walks, the fifth sheep walks, the tenth sheep walks, the 50th sheep walks. All of them one behind the other. If you go to the last sheep and ask him, nobody is dragging you, nobody is beating you, and there's such lovely grass over here, why are you leaving it and going? If that sheep could talk to you, he would probably say, Gotilla Swami, all my friends are going, so I am also going behind them. Don't ask questions outside the syllabus. That is herd mentality. Now, if you truly want to have lasting, sincere, fruitful relationships, please avoid the herd mentality. Everybody is doing it, so I have to do it. My family is doing this, so I have to do it. No, it doesn't work that way. You are first an individual, and then you are somebody's child, somebody's spouse, somebody's parent, somebody's sibling, best friend, whatever you are. So start with this first level of asserting your identity and using this. Ah, using also reminds me. There is a proverb which says, use it or lose it. It starts with inanimate objects. Let's say you had a bicycle which you used to love to ride all the time. Now you are grown up and you just dump that bicycle in the garage or somewhere. And you don't use it. After a very long gap, one fine day you say, I am in the mood for cycling, and you go and try to pull out that cycle. What happens? It doesn't work. The chain is rusty, the air has gone from the tire, the seat is wobbling. Something or the other, it doesn't work. Why? Because unless you use it, you lose it. Anything like that. I'm just giving you an example of this cycle. Now that is an inanimate object. Use it or lose it. I want to extend that to relationships. Use a relationship or lose it. And that is what, now that finally we are coming into the post-pandemic phase. We used to have, what is that? BC and AD, you know? Now it's all going to be BP and AP before the pandemic and after the pandemic, okay? So AP era. In this AP era, for some time you were forced to constrain yourself socializing and relationships. Post-pandemic, what are you doing over it? How are you building, strengthening, redefining? I would even say this is a good opportunity to see who are your true friends and who are not. Among your own family members, relatives, extended family, whoever it is, who are the people who will stand by you and who are the people who don't care for you? These are some of the very, very important things. And along with that, one very, very important thing, perhaps the last point, after which we'll have an open house. Any questions, any comments, we'll take that. One very important thing which happened to relationships, not at the time of this pandemic in 2020, it started somewhere around the year 2000 in a very small way, we didn't even realize it. When we first started getting mobile phones, and of course laptops and tablets and all that, I think around 2005 we started getting smartphones. Till then a phone was a phone. You ask any one of the people of my generation, what is a phone? A phone is an instrument where, you know, it rings, you pick up, somebody is calling you or you are calling somebody, you speak to that somebody and put the phone down. So initially when the mobile phone came, we thought, compared to that, you still remember those black ITI phones with the big dial yes. on it. If you have preserved one of those, it will have great antique value. You will be able to sell it and make a million rupees out of it. Anyway, that was what you had, okay? Now, when the mobile phones came, most of us short-sighted people thought, this is just a phone without a wire. So earlier you had to go to the phone because it had a wire connected to it. Now we are having a phone which I can take and carry with me anywhere else. It will remain the same. Today, 15 years after smartphones came in, do you really think that a mobile phone is just a phone? It has got 100 other things involved in it. And that is why, as I said, I've kept this to the last point. Started in a small way around 2005 and all, when smartphones were very expensive. Money that was charged was so high, you had to pay per second for every calls that you made. Initially, in fact, you had to pay if somebody else called you. Yes. So you wouldn't take calls on your mobile, you would say, call me on the landline, that sort of thing. So it started with that. And people thought that it's very expensive, that sort of thing. Slowly, it came to a point where everything has become free. And as I told you, anything that comes free, and therefore you get into it, You have to think whether it is really the right thing to do or not. In anything to do with life, have you noticed? As you know, Banjara publishes the small booklets. We sell them for 20 rupees. Supposing I were to go to a gathering and put 100 booklets saying, it is free, take one. People will not take one. They will take 2, 3, 4 and walk off with it. There will be hardly anybody who will not pick up a booklet. Then you tell them, please pay 10 rupees and pick up a book. What is 10 rupees today? Many people may not even have a 10 rupee note in their purse. 75% of the people, I'll see it later. I'm busy right now, I'm going. That's a lesson for us. There's another lesson there. People who picked up those free booklets, doesn't matter. They picked it up, they've gone with it. 1 week later, you ask them, hey, you had picked up those booklets of Banjara. How are they? Is it useful? I didn't get time to read it. So I want to even hoard it, but I don't want to use it. That's what happens with relationships. It sounds odd. It sounds funny when I tell it that way. You'll say, how can you compare books to relationship or cycle to relationship or something? But that's reality. We can't get away from that. We can ignore it and pretend that nothing of that sort is happening, but it doesn't mean that it will go away. So I come back to this point which I said I will talk to you about, that you have to ensure that relationships go beyond electronics. If your relationship is dependent on electronics, on the phone or on the tablet or on the laptop or something of that sort, I'm a little apprehensive. I'm not sure that you are on the right track. If your relationships are connected to, you know, social media or something of that sort. Long back, I remember, I had a student who had come from a very small town. And that was a time when young people were getting onto social media. So what happened was, she was telling me that, you know, from my town, many youngsters have moved out, gone to cities like Bangalore or Bombay or Chennai or wherever it is. And they're doing very well. So you know what we did? We formed a social group of people from our hometown, and that too the youngsters. Wow. So we all belong to the same hometown. You know that in that chowk there is that kulfi fellow who used to enjoy that, or that fellow who gives pani puri or something, or this or that. So many nostalgic things. You know, there was a cop who was very strict, and whenever we would go triples on the bike, he would chase us and he would catch up. I was also caught by that same cop. And before you know it, it went viral, as they say. Left, right and center, they were all, you know, they couldn't resist. From morning to evening, continuous flood of messages to each other, as though they become best friends. Then it so happened that some important festivals came together, and many of these people were coming to the hometown at the same time. So this girl took the initiative and said, I know such and such hall or chowdhury or something of that sort, which, you know, my father is connected with. We can get that place free. Why don't we all meet there and have a party? And they were so thrilled. Every one of them said, I'm coming. And they did. And they came there and said, hello. Oh, you are Seema. Okay. You are Kanmani, right. Nice to see you. And full stop. Nobody is talking to each other because they didn't know how to talk face to face. When actually confronted with a live human being, they didn't know how to respond. In the anonymity of the mobile, they could say anything that you wanted. That was an eye-opener. And of course, this is long back. The world has moved much further ahead of that. I don't even want to go into the negative aspects because, you know, you'll say that, okay, just because this fellow is not young and into social media, so that's sour grapes, you know. So maybe he's jealous of the youngsters or something of that sort. No, I'm not. I'm thankful that I don't belong to that generation, so I don't get that temptation or whatever it is. But it's not important what's your age. It's not important how many defined relationships you have, whether you live alone in the house or you live in a small family of 2-3 people, or you live in a joint family of 5 or 10 people, you live in a locality surrounded by your relatives, or you, wherever you do, the point is relationships have to be looked into. And this pandemic has, if you want to take it that way, it has been a very good eye-opener. If you can take these few points and build on yourself, redefine relationships, review your relationships, find out which ones are important and how to change and nurture them and build it up. How many of them you are wasting your time by calling this person part of your friends or relatives or whatever it is. Put out, you know, remove that chaff or whatever you want to call it. You will be able to do it. So let us make the best of whatever this pandemic, lockdown, whatever has happened, and let's start moving into something which is more meaningful. Let us learn a lesson from it and move into something more meaningful. So with that, I'd like to throw it open to all of you. Let's see what.
Ali, you take a minute break, and you all also introspect. So we'll just show Manthan around for
a minute.
And
sure.
Okay, so just keep your questions.
Keep your questions ready.
So hi guys, this is Manthan, and as you see, these are the dormitories. That is a classroom there where we have indoor sessions. There we have two students who are attending their PGDP class. They're waving out to us, if you can see. All right, these are the dormitories. Similarly, there are many other dormitories here. So you have 2-bed dormitories, you have 6-bed dormitories. Right. This is the pathway connecting. It's a beautiful, green, lovely place, as you can see. There's a little pond there, and here is where we do the bonfire, this area, in the evening. So that's where we display our talent and stuff. Quickly moving here. Again, the best are these 6-bed dormitories where, you know, all the friends, we hardly barely sleep at night. It's a lot of chit-chatting and stuff like that. And you can see a swing there. There is a cafeteria where we all eat, and lots of green space where you can walk around. So that's the pond I was talking about. Right now there's no water in that, but during the rainy season it, you know, kind of fills up. So this is our Manthan. All of you are most welcome. The next camp, please do come. And we go back to the amphitheater where we're having the session today. So if you guys have any questions, you can type in. Otherwise, we will take it from the audience. So back to Ali and the session.
Yes, all yours. Let me see what.
Okay.
Your opinion, your comments, your questions.
Thank you.
I believe that pandemic has given an opportunity to open up ourselves. For example, we don't know her before.
Yes.
So we were able to, you know, strike a conversation.
Yes.
Regarding pandemic, at least, right? So
right.
How the since she's a freelancer and an entrepreneur, you know, it gave us an opportunity to, you know, really, you know, engage a conversation. You know,
yes.
Right now, you know. How is the business going? And you know, she said that she's a wedding planner. So wedding has almost taken a hit in this pandemic.
Yes.
So we were able to engage the conversation with her, saying that,
absolutely,
you know, people are when you ask something about the business, you know, either they say that yeah, it's good, or you know, it's average, or it's a little bit of
absolutely right,
you know, down.
Right. And now what you need to do is to build on that.
Exactly.
Otherwise, the pandemic relationship is like a relationship you form in a railway train. When you're going on a 16-hour journey and you sit next to somebody, what do? You introduce yourself and you say, oh, I'm an entrepreneur, I am an accountant, I am this, I am that. And it looks as though you made great friends. And you go back home and say, hey, I had such a lovely time, you know. I had this wonderful person sitting next to me and I got to learn so much. But if somebody asks 1 month later, how many times have you interacted or connected back to this person? It will probably be zero. That is what I want you to understand. That's why when I say post-pandemic relationships, I want you to understand. Otherwise, it will be like that very interesting Santa and Banta joke, no? Santa and Banta were sitting opposite to each other in the railway train. And one person said that my name is Santa and the other one said my name is Banta. And then this one said that, I am going to Amritsar. He said, yes, I am also going to Amritsar. He said, I actually belong to Amritsar. He said, I also belong to Amritsar. Oh, good, nice to know that you are from my hometown. In Amritsar, I live in that Chaliyanwala Gali. Oh, I also live in Chaliyanwala Gali. Oh, you are in the same locality, so nice to meet you. I stay in that Shantinivas building. Oh, I also stay in Shantinivas building. Achha, achha. I stay on the fourth floor. I also stay on the fourth floor. I stay in apartment 404. I also stay in apartment 404. And the people who are listening, they said, kya ho raha hai? You people live in the same apartment and you are having to introduce. He said, nahi yaar, hum dono bhai hain. But you know, in railway journeys, you are supposed to be introducing like that, no? So we are just carrying out the same conversation which we do whenever we meet. This may be a joke, but this is what actually happened. That's why I'm saying, it's wonderful that the pandemic gave you this opportunity. Now the question is, how are you going to utilize that, isn't it? Yes. Yep.
So in the meantime, Sonia here says that nowadays people love to show off their relationships on status pictures and FB. I wonder why can't we tell the person directly who is in front of us and we prefer writing on FB and show
off. Very true, Sonia. Glad I'm that you brought this up. I'm a very strong believer in that. Relationships inevitably should be one-to-one and then you can expand on that. You can't have a group and then try to minimize to an individual. It should always go the other way around.
Yes, Matthew.
Yeah, so I think pandemic was very, very positive for me. It gave me a lot of empowerment. I found myself, like I've heard a lot of people who said, wow, you know, the relationship with me, and I found myself. I found my strength in many things. Something like cooking, right? I was a great carpenter. I was a great electrician. But I also found out how to redefine relationships, right? It gave me so much of empowerment, but I only got it positive. Now I want to be more purposeful in life. As much as I'm single and whatever, I think we all want to do something nice, something good, right? It's beyond pandemic and whatever. And so I think there was a lot of empowerment through pandemic.
Excellent. And if you continue with that, my only contention to all of you, like Matthew, is what are you doing post-pandemic? How are you working on that? In fact, I wanted to tell you, we are all single. Don't forget that. You may have parents, you may have a spouse, you may have children, but deep down inside, we are all single. We are first. And that's the reason why I found so many coming over here and saying, my strongest or my most important relationship is with myself. So doesn't that define you? That it is first me as an individual. And that is what makes good relationships. I've always been convinced about that. If you are complete within yourself, then you will automatically have good relationships.
Okay, Sriram, you have a question.
Ali, quick question. Now, after the pandemic, most of us are going to go back into having our old lives, like going back to work and interacting with people. There is going to be a little bit of social anxiety which is going to be causing between a lot of people.
Yes.
And secondly, relationships are not going to be the same because we are going to have separation anxiety between people now. Because you'll be more worried what's happening at home than you're sitting there at work.
Yes.
How do we go about addressing that then?
We go about addressing that by reviewing, exactly like Matthew said just now. What have I learned? What have I gained? What have I not gained? And most important, I connect back to the same point. What I have gained, am I putting it to long-term use? If I decide that since I'm here in Manthan and there is a badminton court or something, I will learn badminton. I'll play every day for the next 15 days that I'm here in Manthan. But when I go back and I don't, you know, take advantage or practice the game that I have learned, it is of absolutely no use. The same thing comes back to relationships. In fact, you know, we are talking about different strains of the pandemic. Somebody said in UK a different strain is coming from Africa. Something is coming. Suddenly somebody said from animals something is coming. So all that is going on. There are two syndromes which have shot up during this pandemic. One is called zero inbox syndrome. Zero inbox syndrome. I have to answer every mail that is there in my inbox. I cannot go to sleep, I cannot eat, I cannot do anything else till I bring my inbox to zero. That is the type of compulsion that has come. And the things in the inbox may not even have anything to do with me, it may not even be addressed to me. You know, as somebody was saying, it may be announcing somebody's appreciation of somebody else and it has been sent to so many people and I have also received that. But I have to make sure that I respond to it or something, including, you know, that like thing which comes in. The other day somebody was telling me that somebody announced that, you know, my very beloved aunt died and there were so many likes. So I don't know what they intended to convey. Yes, Archana, go ahead.
Biggest pandemic which has hit the world is loneliness, I think.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Because, you know, in any relationship when we are there, it's everyone knows that we are all alone at the end of a day, but still we have the expectation with the relationship.
That's right. That's right.
So how to handle the expectation and at the same time be alone? Like,
yes.
What we say is like, don't get attached. We have to be detached when we are still in the relationship.
Yeah.
So how to do that?
Again, I come back to what we call as the human touch and the one-to-one relationship. Whoever it may be a vague neighbor in your building, it may even be the security guard in your building. Now, are you maintaining a one-to-one with that person? Do you stop and inquire about his family or his well-being or anything of that sort? Do you have that equation where out of 300 people who walk in through the security gate, when he looks at Archana ma'am, his face goes like this. Oh, madam, kaisa hai aap? You know, that is what I define as relationship, even a simple thing like that. But what do people do? You have some crowdfunding. We have this security man who's mother has got cancer, so please contribute, and there are 500 people who contribute 10 times the amount that mother needs, and we all feel very thrilled with it, and we don't know what mother, what treatment and what where that money went or something of that sort. That is what I keep coming back to. You're absolutely right about this loneliness. In fact, I started talking about this loneliness as the greatest epidemic, you know, 20 years back. People have not listened to me and people are still not listening to me. When you talk about being alone, the second syndrome that has come in is called the phantom vibration syndrome. Phantom vibration syndrome. You know, when we are in a group or something of that sort, we turn our phones to vibration mode, so it doesn't ring. Now, I am sitting here happily talking to my friend or participating in this, and I get a feeling that my phone is vibrating. When I pull it out, it is not vibrating. This is actually happening to people. I'm not exaggerating. It's a syndrome which people are getting concerned about. So these are some of the things where you need to, coming back to Archana's question, to be able to work on to ensure that we are vaccinated against this epidemic of loneliness. And what does it take? I gave you the example of stopping for 30 seconds every time you go in and out of your building to chat up with the security man. And out of four security people who are there, three of them may be grumpy fellows who don't even reply to you. And he may turn and say, kya chahiye madam, nahi kuch nahi chahiye, rehne de, and you move on. But you will definitely find somebody who will respond to you. And that's how you start building. You become selective. You start building on those relationships. It's not difficult. It does not, you know, it's not rocket science or something that you have to, you know, put in a lot of research and learn. But one thing is for sure. You have to make it second nature. You have to keep practicing it so much that you don't even have to make an active effort. I know so many people who do that. They meet somebody in the neighborhood, they go to a shopkeeper, even a new shopkeeper, and they ask one or two personal questions, ki yaar dhanda kaisa chal raha hai, or whatever it is, or do you find that this stock of this is good, or something of that sort. You're going in a cab or in an auto rickshaw and you ask one sensitive question to the person, and the person will give you his entire biography. In that 20 minutes that you are riding with that person, you'll get to know everything about his life. And not only he feels nice, you get a sense of satisfaction. I'm not even saying that you have to build a relationship with that person, but that also I've seen. I've seen some of our Banjarites who got into this habit of, let's say, talking to the auto rickshaw driver whenever he comes, and they found that when they come down from the building, that same auto rickshaw is waiting there. Amma, you want to go to Banjara Artinagar? No, but what are you doing here? No, I knew around this time you go, so I thought I will come here. Yes, Archana. Yes, yes.
Yeah, yes. Every class Saturday, Sunday, there is one auto rickshaw. Which is standing in their auto rickshaw stand.
Yeah.
And the moment he sees me, he'll come and stand in front of me so that I can go, you know. Right. So it's happening.
Exactly.
Last many months.
Now, would you call that a relationship? I would.
Yes.
Yeah.
You don't have to look for those very close, very intimate, very meaningful or deep relationships. Your quality of life improves if you have 5 people like that in your day-to-day routine. Your day goes beautifully. You may have some negative inputs. You may have people being not very nice to you. This counterbalances that.
And how safe are they? Suddenly out of the blue they come in,
100%, 100%. I've never come across any case where a person has done it out of extra interest. If it is based on this. You see, if she is doling out extra money, or if she is heavily decked up or wearing jewelry, and then this fellow is coming, then you can say, maybe he's come to rob her or something of that sort. But when she has been sensitive and she has spoken nicely to him and he comes, he is also a man looking for love. Imagine the loneliness of an auto rickshaw driver who morning to night has people behind him but nobody in front of him to talk to.
Yeah, I think Ali Farana has a question.
Yes, Farana, go ahead.
I don't know if I missed out the first part. I don't know what it was asked.
Doesn't
I don't
matter.
Know if it's connected to this.
Yeah.
In pandemic, there were lots of people who were very close and they were happy with it. There were many couples and families which were always fighting and separation. And how did we go about with that? But what was missing in it, like, in a sense?
Yes. I don't have a standard answer for it. But one thing I'd like to tell you is that if such a thing has happened, let that also be a wake-up call. So sometimes we say, I got this severe stomachache or something and I went to the doctor, and then I came to know that it could have led to something very serious, and because I had that stomachache or that fever, that's why it got saved. So this argument, this unpleasantness or whatever happened in the pandemic, don't say that, okay, now the pandemic is over, now we can step out, so we are not fighting anymore. No, you have to say, when we were locked in, why is it we could not get along? Why is it there was so much conflict? And that again has to be done on one-to-one basis. If you have 2 people or 5 people in the family, don't lump them together and say, I have very good relationship with my family, or I have bad relationship with my family. There's no such thing as family. The same way, as I said, we are individuals. Every person, you may love them all. You may have a spouse, you may have children, you may have a mother, and you may be very deeply loving them. But please treat them as individuals. And don't lump them together. Expand that to friends, expand that to society, and expand that to the whole world. The world is awaiting you. The pandemic is over. The government lockdown has almost closed. The last of the things, I think, were swimming pools, which are also opening.
They've opened,
now. Schools are opening. Today's paper said even 6th standard children are going to go to school. The government lockdown is being lifted. But the mental lockdown, I'm not sure where it stands. Let us work on that and have a wonderful time.
Right.
Thank you. And bye-bye.
Thank you.
Ali, another last question. We have another 5 minutes here.
Yes,
so somebody,
FP. Kumar says, what is the reason that we remember or recollect only unfortunate things instead of the good ones?
Yeah. That is because somewhere deep down inside me, there is a resentment. There are unresolved issues.
So the moment something negative happens, if I come here and if I meet 40 people, 39 were good to me. One person is rude to me. At the end of the day, whom do I remember? Only that. When I go back home, whom do I talk about? Only that one person. Now, it has nothing to do with that one person. Wherever I go, one out of 40 people is going to be bad to me. That's part of statistics. But it's up to me to ask, why did I focus on that negativity?
Right.
So you're taking the last question from...
Yes, Suma. Yeah.
I like meeting people, new people and all of that. And I tend to have that habit where I talk to people.
Wonderful.
But I have two younger sisters who are quite relatively very shy.
Right.
So although, I mean, and I'm pretty sure that, you know, people who are shy also go through this time where they feel lonely, and especially
yes.
because it's more difficult for them to actually interact with people when they're in a group or something like
very
that.
Very true.
So you said that, you know, every time to build a relationship, to not feel lonely, just make that small extra effort of talking and, you know, interacting and all of that. How do people who are relatively shy, what do they do to get a, I mean, you know, make that,
yeah.
take that
yeah.
extra
More
step.
Than what they do, I would say, since they are people close to you, be it your sisters, be it your close friends or whatever it is, you make that effort. See, you have something which these people don't have. You are an extrovert, they are introverts. Supposing you knew how to ride a cycle and both your sisters did not know how to ride a cycle, what would you do? You would hold the cycle and say, hey, I'm there. See, I'll demonstrate to you. It's not all that difficult. I can ride. I learnt in so many days. Come on, now you sit down. I'll hold the cycle and we'll go ahead. So come with me. Come. We'll go to Manthan. No, I feel very shy. I don't know what to say and all that. Don't. Just come and sit next to me. I'll talk to people. You come and sit with me. When somebody is conversing with me, you be part of that conversation, just sit and listen. When she is agreeable to do that, turn to her and say, what is your opinion on this? She will mumble, she will say a few things. Give a positive stroke. That's how you take it forward. It can be done. Every one of us is capable of building relationship. There is no such thing as a permanent introvert or a permanent shy person. It's only circumstances that make a person that way. Every person is capable of building good relationships. We have to put in that efforts. Thank you.
Okay, thank you guys for joining us.